Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening. Welcome to the first BrisScience of 2017. Yes. This is great. Spontaneous applause. That is fantastic. We are, of course, presented tonight by the University of Queensland and hosted here at the wonderful The Edge part of the State Library. I would also like to respectfully acknowledge the traditional owners of the land that we're meeting tonight and elders past and present. And I also want to recognise those whose continued efforts to protect and promote Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander cultures will leave a lasting legacy for future elders and leaders. So tonight, we are going to be taking a deep dive into sharks. And this is an appropriate topic for a couple of reasons. Firstly, we've all got to experience firsthand on the way in what it's like to live underwater. And thank you for all making it out tonight. But also, it's a topical question because sharks are unfortunately in the news all too often and for all the wrong reasons. Not because they're amazing animals that have been around for 400 million years, but because of shark attacks. And it seems like we hear them more and more often. But is that really true? And of course, at the end of the day, being able to coexist with nature relies on really understanding the world around us. So tonight, to that end, we have three fantastic researchers on sharks, from biology to behaviour, and they're going to do some presentations tonight and then take some questions from you, the audience. So it's your chance to fish for whatever information you would like. Thank you. Yes, it's going to be tough tonight to resist the fish puns. Fortunately, though, jokes about sharks are fairly thin on the ground. Okay, so just a couple little bits of housekeeping. We take questions at the end of all three speakers. We'll have a little bit of a panel discussion. And you can ask questions in two ways. One is you can write them down on a piece of paper you got on the way in. And then Leonie and the others will collect those questions and we'll get to as many of those as we can. Or you can ask questions on your smartphone through Twitter, hashtag BrisScience. Which you will have seen up on the screen there a couple of times. So we'll switch between paper and Twitter depending on how technologically the balance is in our audience tonight. And then afterwards, as I said, we will have food and discussion, a chance to ask some more questions at the end. I think that is all I need to say to get started. So without further ado, I would like to welcome our first speaker tonight, who is Associate Professor Ian Tibbetts. He's the Director of the Centre for Marine Science at the University of Queensland, of course, and he teaches ichthyology and marine biology and has published on a substantial range of different size fish, from gobies all the way up to tiger sharks. And tonight he's talking about the physiology of sharks. Could you please welcome Ian Tibbetts?
Thank you all. Particularly like to thanks the organisers of this evening's activities, particularly the science faculty at the University of Queensland. They don't usually let me out after dark, so this is a nice experience. And today, it's a pleasure to start off the set and with some background information about sharks. And particularly the pelagic ones. We're going to hear about some other sorts of shark in a little while, but I'm going to focus on the ones that might chew you a little bit. So we'll talk about those. I'll say a little bit about the evolution. Joel's kind of stolen part of my thunder with his 400 million year line, but that's okay. We'll move on. And then I'll move on, talk a little bit about what happened just before a shark bites you. Isn't that what you came here for? How to tell if you're going to get bitten or not. We'll get a bit of that. And then what the special sense of sharks, how that allows them to nibble you effectively and efficiently, all right? So a little bit about that. And then I will slide off the stage and then give way to my colleagues. So this opening, and I've got to be careful, there are two green buttons here, they do different things. This one's the laser. So this is Bonnie Holmes. She's got a PhD now, and Bonnie worked in my lab and Mike Bennett's lab studying tiger sharks, and here she's attaching a satellite tag to the shark. So there's some very brave students out there. Usually I focus on the goby end of things, little fish about that big. I let my students work with the dangerous stuff, all right? It's not for me. I'm very OHS aware. This is the green button that moves things forwards. So shark evolution. The other thing I should point out to you, that I hope we'll be able to make the presentations available online in some form after it. And there'll be a few URLs. Some of these URL, for those of you that don't know, is a thing you put into a search thing to find a thing. I don't know what tweeting is yet. I'm hashtag confused, yeah? Anyway, so... Is that all right? Is that wrong? They're filming. You filming me now? No, all right. Yeah. Anyway, so there'll be a few of those in there, so you have a look for the source of information there. But this is a graphic. This is a Discovery UK. I'll say a little bit about Discovery at the end of this. But sharks basically have a very deep root in evolutionary history. So way back before dinosaurs were ever thought of, there was a massive radiation of fishes in a period called the Devonian. It was about 400 million years ago or so. Recent research suggests that radiation probably took place in the Permian, which is the period before that. This is a very long time ago. We hear about, you've heard about Gondwana. We're in Gondwana, right? This is it. And maybe some of you might have heard of Pangaea, which is when all the continents were together. That was about 200 million years ago. That's half the time sharks have been on this planet. All these massive movements of continents around the Earth were taking place while sharks were dominating the seas. And sharks were a big experiment in vertebrates, things like us, in moving from the seabed into the water column and then finding out how to move around efficiently. And they've spent 440 million years practicing, all right? So when you try and outrun a shark and you've spent a few weeks in the pool, just remember how the outcome might go, all right? So my money's on the shark. So the form, you'll notice, the structure, this is the green button that makes light, all right? So the form, you'll notice, even back 300, 400 million years ago, was largely recognizable as a modern-day shark. So the bowel plan, the structure of the body, has changed very little. There's a propulsive unit at the back, there's some finny things at the front, and then there's a big grin on its face while it charges at you with teeth, all right? So this evolutionary sequence spanning across this massive amount of time has generated this body form that we see swimming around today. So 400 million years of practice. So, this is the green button that moves things on. This is the general body plan of a shark. Now, sharks are reasonably constrained in the diversity of form, particularly those that swim up in the water column. All right, so they generally, if they're this one is what's called a pelagic, which is something that swims up in the water column. It's a predator of things that are reasonably large. All right, whale sharks are still predators, but they eat very small things. All right, just because thing is small doesn't mean it's not an animal. All right, so these things are feeding on fairly large things, and they're swimming up in the water column, and they have this morphology where they have a big tail at the end that flaps back and forth. They have these big fins at the front. Now, what are they for? Now, those, you can tell the shape of the body, it's streamlined, so it's going to move through the water pretty efficiently. The tail is to push against the water so that it drives the shark forward. The tail is asymmetric, it bends up at the end. So it's like if you make a fish, it's like an eel thing, and you bend up the end of the spine, and then you put some connective tissue at the bottom of it, that's a shark's tail, all right? And you're probably familiar with shark tails. So that thing drives it forward. It lacks something in here, all right? Now, what, I didn't put a picture of a bony fish up. What bony fish have inside them, those that swim in the water, is like a sack of gas inside. It's oxygen they secrete from the blood, and they can change the volume of that or the amount of gas in there. That allows bony fish to be neutrally buoyant. But sharks don't have that. When they were part of their early evolution, left any prospect of that behind. They lost a lot of the bone, all right, so they're not just cartilaginous fishes, they've got ossified elements, bony kind of stuff. And they moved up into the water column, and because they are still negatively buoyant, they will sink. You may be seeing some of these horrific shows where there's, you know, they're finning sharks and throwing them over the side of the boats. Horrendous stuff. When they throw the shark back in, it sinks down to the bottom. It's negatively buoyant. You throw a bony fish in with a swim bladder, it floats, right? So there's this fundamental difference. So sharks try and get around it. They have a liver that's filled with squalene, which is a very light oil. So it reduces their overall buoyancy. Increases their overall buoyancy with respect to gravitational effects in the water. So the other thing that's going on is this tail being asymmetric tends to cause asymmetric forward thrust. Right? It's going to make it dive slightly. So What it has to have is these big fins at the front, these big pectoral fins, yeah? They're equivalent of our arms, all right? They're homologous with our arms. They're the same thing, basically, of a vertebrate. So when you want to think about who invented arms, it's the ancestor of all of us that did that, and the shark is related to us. So that's the body plan of the animal with respect to locomotion. Now, what can it do? Well, here's some performance figures. I've stolen these from another site, and if you can hunt up the URLs down here. But basically, if you want to look at some of the performance figures, here's a human. This is actually 5 miles an hour, if you can't read it. Now, 5 miles an hour is roughly about 7-8 kilometers an hour. That's an Olympic swimmer at top speed. That's how fast they can swim. And if you go up here, I've converted this into KPH. So a blue shark, 56 kilometers an hour. Great white, up to 56. 74 kilometers an hour for a short fin mako shark, the fastest of the sharks. So 74 kilometers an hour, possible hot top speed, is an amazing performance for an animal swimming through the water. And there's videos online, if you look up short fin mako video, and you can see these things following boats and following lures put behind boats. And the remarkable thing is they chase after this boat. They might take a fish from the lure thing, drop back while they eat it, and then swim back up again and take another one. These things are really going at a fair speed. All right, in terms of other performance, so outswimming a shark, unless it's a very dull shark down here somewhere, and there are very few of them that swim at that speed, you don't stand a chance. If you're standing out of the water, you better watch out as well, because they can jump. And here's the short fin mako again. One might expect that the fastest shark is always the highest jumper. So 30 feet, 10 meters up in the air it can get and snatch you from your platform. So when you see people leaning over the side of a thing feeding killer whales, right, don't do it with sharks. If you say, they might take you. Right? So they're pretty efficient things. They're scared, you know. I treat them with great deal of respect. I swim with sharks quite frequently, but usually I'm surrounded with students, so it doesn't reduce the risk. I take them. I go on a thing called night snorkeling. All right, it's how to be scared. All right, so on the reef we'll go out night snorkeling. We'll all have a flashlight, and basically I'll have a group of students, and then I will lead. All right, so I'm the boss. So I have a special colored light, which means I'm the leader. And then the others can follow me, all right? And I tell them all, I say, whatever you do, don't be last. Surprising how they keep up, you know. Did we lose one? Oh, yeah. He was at the back. Yeah, sorry. Anyway. Well, this is what happens to you right close up. So the shark's done its major speed thing. You're flopping around at 5 kilometers an hour, 5 miles per hour, because you've panicking a bit, there's a shark following you, I want to get away. But what the shark does just before it bites you is it closes its eyes. All right? This is particularly in the big predatory sharks, such as the great white, which this is. So this is an eyelid. There are not many fishes have eyelids, but its thing is called a nictitating membrane. It slides over the shark's eye just before it bites you. So before it bites you, the shark is blind. Can't see you. So is it your opportunity to duck away quietly? Don't think so. Because the shark has the sixth sense. And the sixth sense in this shark, that's a bit of a she sells seashells by the seashore kind of thing. But anyway, so the sixth sense in this shark are these little blobby things around the snout region. And those are the ampullae of Lorenzini. The ampullae of Lorenzini. Well, they're actually quite special organs, and they form part of an electrical sense. So we all give off electricity. Some of us more than others, but we all give off electricity just by respiring, all right? Just by having muscles and having those muscles do work, you create an electric field around yourself. Now, in the air, well, it's not terribly easy to sense that directly, but in the water, which is a reasonable conductor, particularly salt water, that's a pretty good thing to use if you want to home in on a prey. So use the sense of electroreception, and that's what these ampullae of Lorenzini are for, to sense the electrical fields generated by an organism you wish to bite. Now, how long have we known about these ampullae of Lorenzini? Well, actually for hundreds of years. And if we link back and have a look at the name, we find out that it was an Italian person that found them first. Conveniently, he was called Lorenzini. And Stefano Lorenzini, and he did it for the greater good of Ferdinando III and the head of Tuscany, and he looked at a thing called a torpedo ray, which is one of the flattened lasmobranchs, lives on the seabed, and actually generates the name we might know it by as the numfish. So it actually makes electricity like an electric eel, if you've heard of those. So it actually can electrocute you. So it uses electricity in the water to stun prey and deter predators, potentially. So he did diagrams of the layout of this these organs, and he also did layout and diagrams of the mysterious canals that seem to run under the flesh of the organism. And these are actually drawings that we repeat today. This is one of the shovel nose rays, and here's a drawing of these ampullae of Lorenzini, their distribution. So we use those because when we have a look at the distribution of the ampullae of Lorenzini, we can tell something about what the shark, how the shark might feed or how it might react to predators. So this is 1678. That's a reasonable chunk of time ago when the structure was first identified. But the behavior wasn't identified until a person called Ad Calmain came along and did some really interesting work. So what Ad did was he put some prey, fish, in chambers that were isolated from the medium other than the electric sense. So the shark couldn't smell them, the shark couldn't detect any movement from them. The only thing that was leaking out of these chambers was the electrical field around the fish. And then, of course, being a good scientist, he did some controls of this and found out when the live fish was in the container that it would be targeted by the shark. He followed up with some other experiments using various forms of conductor, iron bars, for example, in a salty environment, will generate an electrical field. So sharks will naturally find things that generate some sort of electrical charge, all right, some sort of voltage differential in the water. And those are detected by these structures. And they're quite sensitive. So Ad Calmain came along and sort of did his work and sorted out this stuff, which we're now using today. And this is 2008 from a paper, a student I did. And then here's what the structure looks like in a little bit more detail. So this is a graphic showing you the underside of a stingray. Here's the pectoral fin, because the flappy bits on a stingray are just the pectoral fin in a different form. It's a type of locomotion done a different way than the direction the pelagic sharks we're talking about went. Oh, rats. Hang on, sorry. I'm letting the back thing, the green, other green button. All right, so there's these in the shark head. We can identify these pits in the surface of the skin, and they lead down to canals, which are like this. So there's a surface pore, and there's a surface pore there. There's a canal, and then a bulb at the end linked up to a nerve. All right. So there's a hole in the skin, a long canal, and then a bulb at the end. Now, the sensory cells sit in this bulb. I'll show you a picture of them in a minute. And this canal is filled with a conductive jelly. So the cells lining the canal secrete a mucus, a type of mucus that's fairly clear, it's viscous, and it's highly conductive. And so there's not water moving in this. And actually, if you happen to come across a shark, you know, while it's chewing your leg off, probably just press around the snout region. You'll see these little holes, and you'll see mucus well out of it. And that's the conductive stuff. So you may as well do something while you're, like, you know, bleeding out. So that's the structure. I'm peering around, yeah, okay, for Joel, just in case I get pulled off stage any second for misspeaking. Anyway, this is the organ itself, all right? So this is at the end bit. Here's the pore up here, the canal, and then at the end of it, it has these various bulbs called alveoli, and there's nerves leading from those, and those go, and they tell the animal something's happening. So if you have an array of these over the surface of the body, you can build a picture. We don't know what it looks like, but we know they can resolve certain things. They can't identify, they can't discriminate among species of things that are buried, hidden from them, or things that are about to bite. But they can tell that something's there. They can localize it very well. So have a look. I'm not going to run any videos. Others will do that. But I've put some of these URLs up, which are links to videos, which you can find out more about these things by looking at the structures. So these are scanning electron micrographs. These are actually shark scales. Right, placoid scales, they're like teeth that stick out through the skin, and they're fluted to allow the shark to move efficiently through the water. So they reduce the turbulence over the surface of the shark. And there's an ampullary pore, ampullary of Lorenzini pore. So that leads down to a canal. The canal runs down through the tissues, the epidermis, and then it runs into this sensory cells at the end. You can see all the sensory cells, there's little blobs in there, lining these six or seven pits inside this ampulla. It's pretty remarkable stuff, really, that it, they have these things. So anyway, so that's the structure of the organ that does it, and this is the thing that's going to sense you immediately before the bite while the eye is closed, all right, while the nictitating membrane is drawn. How sensitive is it? Well, it's pretty sensitive. A juvenile shark can detect electric fields less than 1 nanovolt per centimeter squared. For those of you who don't know what a nanovolt is, 1 volt is 1 billion nanovolts. So if you have a 4-volt battery, you've got 4 billion nanovolts of potential in there. So these things are absolutely remarkable. So this is an equivalent. So a torch battery placed underwater and connected to electrodes 16,000 kilometers away. That's how sensitive it is. It's so sensitive that when I first start, I'll show you a picture of the chap I first started working with on this sort of sharky area of electroreception. We were funded by the Defence Science Technology Organisation because we were working on fishes that lived in estuarine environments like the estuary out here. And actually, we were working in the estuary here. And they were very interested in ways of detecting mines in variable salinity environments. So they gave us $100,000 to kick off this research. That's where we kind of got started on this area. So we published a bit on it now. Anyway, so this is a little hammerhead shark, and I'm sure it's convinced. I put a hammerhead up, so they're quite interesting. Of the shark species that are likely to bite you, this is not one. They're quite happy. They go 14, 15 foot long. They're big, swimming and mock around. They eat stingrays. They love stingrays. If you want to catch a shark, stingray is the best bait, all right? So you can catch a stingray, put half a stingray on with a chain and a big hook. And then you wait there with a broom handle. And you give it to a student to hold. Right? So it's pretty sensitive. Students are useful, actually. They're pretty good. The only reason I'm still here is because the students went before me. Anyway, so I'm going to almost leave it there, okay? I just would point you to a couple of things. One, Shark Week is coming up. So Shark Week's available through Discovery Channel and that sort of thing. It's coming up in June 2017. We get the release in our summer. I don't see why they want to match it with their summer and our summer. Maybe it's a thing to do with shark attack numbers. I don't know. Anyway, whatever. But Shark Week, so that goes in. Some it's a little bit crass. Some of it may be a bit dubious. But anyway, that's Shark Week. And the other thing is, it's very credible and very, very good because I'm in it, is the Sharks Global Biodiversity, Biology and Conservation. And that's produced by Cornell University and the University of Queensland. So Willie Bemis and I, he's a professor over there, and I worked on this sort of shark thing together. So you can go onto that site. You can download little snippets of information. You can read some stuff. You don't have to sign up to do the course, but the course is opening later in the middle of the year, around about June 27th. You can sign on through edX at UQ. And if you want to find more about sharks, you will find it there. Now, the very last thing I'm going to say, Joel, you're not dragging me off yet, am I right? What have I got? I'm learning.
Negative four?
What button? That? I can wind time back. Is that the button down here? That one. Okay, this one here. So these are a few references. It's always nice for scientists occasionally to put in a few citations about stuff that they've talked about. So there are a few here. And this is Daryl. Daryl's from Louisiana. That's a catfish. What? He's from Louisiana. You've seen the TV shows, haven't you? Anyway, he's Dr. Daryl Whitehead, and he studied catfish. He rang me up from Louisiana, from the bayou, and 20 years ago, we had a lunch about 3 weeks ago to celebrate the 20th anniversary of Daryl coming out and doing his PhD. And he rings me up from the bayou, and this is before internet and stuff like that, and Twitter and whatever. And he rings me up and says, I can't do the accent, but you'll want to do some research on sharks with me, or something like that, He's ringing from the, I've never done work on sharks. I work on gobies, I try and tell him, all right, okay. So I think the next thing up in size between a shark and a goby is probably something like a catfish. I knew they were electroreceptive. Anyway, so we worked on catfish for a whole bunch of time. And just as one interesting passing fact, while I've been focusing on electroreception in sharks, interestingly, bony fishes derived independently of sharks. They had their own system. And in the Brisbane River, we have found the catfish with the longest electroreceptors of any teleost in the world, any bony fish in the world. So there's a record there. We're just checking out. We have others that might win. So just because I'm focusing on sharks, I'd like to say, offer a few words on their food and thank Daryl very much for his years of contributions to science at UQ. Thank you.
Fantastic, Ian. And if anybody is interested in doing a PhD with Ian, you can check out the website, always vacancies. Very high turnover. Our next speaker tonight is Dr. Christine Dudgeon, who is a researcher in the Shark and Ray Laboratory and also the Molecular Fisheries Laboratories at UQ. Chris investigates the population ecology and evolution of marine organisms, and tonight is going to be talking about Leonie the Leopard Shark. Please welcome Chris Dudgeon.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Joel. And I'd just like to say I'm really glad that I wasn't one of Ian's students. So tonight I will be talking about reproduction in sharks and rays, and particularly more about an unusual form of reproduction where males are not necessarily required, hence my title, Who Needs Boys Anyway? So I'll start talking a bit more generally about asexual reproduction, and then more specifically about this special case of Leonie the leopard shark. Now, back in January, we published this paper demonstrating Leonie's particular technique of reproduction, and I published this together with colleagues of mine from the Reef HQ Aquarium in Townsville and the Molecular Fisheries Laboratory here at UQ. And this paper received considerable media attention. And while I was spending time looking through commentaries online under different news feeds, I kept seeing this picture coming up. Now, some of you may recognize this as Jeff Goldblum, and some of you may even recognize this in character as Dr. Malcolm from the 1993 hit movie Jurassic Park. Now, I haven't seen Jurassic Park since about 1993, so I thought it was time to revisit it together with my family. Yes, I've seen it then since, together with you. For those of you who aren't familiar with this film, the premise is that a fossilized mosquito is found that has blood in it from a dinosaur. DNA from that blood is taken and used to create dinosaurs in the modern era. They're contained on this theme park island called Jurassic Park. Now, this bit of it comes in at a scene where Dr. Wu, the chief scientist of Jurassic Park, is explaining how they use population control. And essentially, they create only females in the laboratory that are then released into the wild. And so his idea is that they won't reproduce. Now, Dr. Malcolm is an expert in chaos theory, and he's a little bit skeptical about this. So I have a little video snippet here of that scene. Tony, if you could play, please.
You're implying that a group composed entirely of female animals will breed?
No, I'm simply saying that life finds a way.
And that is the meme, yes. Life finds a way, no true words were spoken. So, was Michael Crichton, who was the author of this book, was he a scientific clairvoyant? Or perhaps was he familiar with some research that had been published by then that demonstrated asexual reproduction in descendants of dinosaurs? The poultry. So in fact, a scientist named Olson did a lot of work back in the 1950s and 60s on asexual reproduction in poultry. So this has been around for quite some time. So what do we know about asexual reproduction in vertebrate species? So while asexual reproduction is quite common in plants and microorganisms and small invertebrates, so things like insects and jellyfish, it's much more rare in vertebrates, so those large animals with a backbone. And the last census in 2008 was that less than 0.1% of all known vertebrate species demonstrated some form of asexual reproduction. But it's pretty widespread, so it's found, examples are found in bony fish and sharks, in amphibians, in reptiles, and in birds. to date, there are no known natural occurrences of asexual reproduction in mammals. So you can be rest assured you will not spontaneously fall pregnant. Now, asexual reproduction comes in many forms. We often think about animals budding off and just making a new genetically identical daughter or a plant which you can cultivate and propagate a new plant which is genetically identical. But the particular form that I'll talk about is known as parthenogenesis, and this translates directly from the Greek for virgin birth. And this is where you have asexual reproduction and embryos develop, but there's no fertilization. And there's a particular form of parthenogenesis which is most widespread in the vertebrates and what we see in sharks and rays, which is known as facultative parthenogenesis. And this is where normally sexually reproducing species sometimes reproduce asexually. And there was a famous example of a Komodo dragon that came out last decade. So currently, parthenogenesis has been recorded in 8 different species of sharks and rays, and these span quite diverse groupings, so 2 different orders and several families. It includes sharks and rays that lay eggs, as well as ones that give live birth. Most of these examples, in most of these examples, we either don't know the sexual history of the individual, or they've started reproducing asexually when they've reached maturity. Most of these examples come from captive environments. However, this particular one down here, this is a sawfish, that's a kind of ray. There was a study conducted in the southern USA where they screened several hundred sawfish and found parthenogenetic signatures in 5 wild individuals. The reason that they inferred that this happened is that the parthenogenetic offspring have a very distinctive genetic signature, and I'm going to explain that briefly now. So if you come back with me to Biology 101, sexual reproduction, sharks and rays are quite similar to us in many aspects of their sexual reproduction. So firstly, male sharks have claspers, so this is pretty much like a penis that it inserts into the female, and they have internal fertilization, have sex. So also, sharks and rays have XY sex determination. So very similar to us. So it depends on if the father contributes a Y chromosome to the offspring, they are male. If the father contributes an X chromosome to the offspring, they're female. The other thing about sharks and rays, which is different to a lot of bony fish, is that they don't change sex. If they're a male from birth, they stay male the whole time. So bony fish are a lot more flexible in their sex determination. The other thing that I'd like to point out is that sharks and rays, similar to us again, are diploid. So they receive half of their DNA from mum and half of their DNA from dad. And here I have a hypothetical example. If we just look at one gene region, so of course our DNA is made up of millions of gene regions, so this is just an example of one. So here, mum has 2 gene copies, but they differ to each other. Dad has 2 gene copies and they differ to each other. And mum and dad don't share any. So these offspring could have one of any of these 4 combinations of those genes. So what happens when we have parthenogenesis? Well, basically we just get rid of dad. And because we now have no paternal input, we also don't have any boys. So we end up with all girls in this case. Now, here, the offspring will either receive gene copy 1 or gene copy 2 from mum. And the important thing to note is that the offspring are not going to be identical to each other. They're also not identical to their mum because they only have half of her genetic diversity. And, So the next bit is that you can see here that these gene copies have been duplicated. Now, this is something I get asked quite a lot. Now, how does this actually happen? Now, the short answer is we don't know. The long answer is that there are a couple of different kinds of genetic mechanisms that can result in this very distinctive genetic signature. So we can infer which ones it might be. Often the one that is proposed is something called terminal fusion automixis. Just remember that for the quiz later. And what that means is that during the process of making the egg cells that usually would fuse together with the sperm to make the embryo, those egg cells actually fuse together with another cell of complementary DNA that's made by the mother in the same process. So in a way, it's like self-fertilization. But again, we're not really sure if that's the exact mechanism or not. So now I would like to talk to you more specifically about this study on leopard sharks that we published recently. And I'd like to introduce you to Leo and Leonie, the breeding pair of leopard sharks that live in the Reef HQ Aquarium up in Townsville. Now, up here, I've got in brackets zebra shark. That's a common name that's used for this species too. I'll explain why that is in a little bit. This picture is actually, I love this picture because it's showing them in the act. This is pre-copulatory behavior. So one of the very distinctive things that this species does is that the male will swim up, bite the tail of the female while she's swimming along, and then she goes all floppy, and then he can position her for the next bit. So, interestingly, we use this technique to catch them in the wild, and it works on males too. I'm not sure why. The other thing I'd like to mention about Leo here, he was captured from the wild as a large animal in 1985 and placed in this aquarium. He died 2 years ago, so he is the oldest known leopard shark, or was the oldest known leopard shark in the world, and would have been at least 40 years old, but we don't know exactly how old he was at that time. So Leo and Leonie were a very successful breeding pair, and over a series of about 4 years, they had 26 pups. So because they were so successful, Leo got turfed out of the tank. So as a baby, they're pretty little, but these animals grow over 2 meters in length. So you can imagine it's quite difficult to house 26 2-meter-long sharks in one aquarium that live for 40 years or so as well. So Leo was removed. The next year, Leonie didn't lay any eggs. So these are egg layers, and much like a chicken, they'll lay eggs if the conditions are good, whether the eggs are fertile or infertile. At this time, however, Lolly, who was one of the eldest offspring of Leo and Leonie, she was placed into the tank with her mum. The following year, which is 2 years after the removal of Leo, Leonie started laying eggs again. And there were embryos observed developing in 6 of those eggs, but none of them survived to hatching. Lolly, later in that year, also started laying eggs. Now, Lolly was around 6 years old and approaching maturity, so these were not very well-developed eggs, and she didn't have any embryos in those. The following year, which is 3 years after the removal of Leo, both Lolly and Leonie were laying eggs. Embryos were observed in the eggs from both of the sharks, and in fact, pups hatched out of eggs from both of the sharks. So the question is, how on earth did all these pups and embryos after the removal of Leo come to be? So the first thought was sperm storage. Now, sharks are known to store sperm for up to 4 years, or over 4 years, so this study was certainly well within those boundaries. But Lolly, the younger shark, never had access to a male. So sperm storage didn't seem plausible for her. And the alternative explanation was parthenogenesis. So this was known from several shark species already, including from a leopard shark in an aquarium in Dubai. Now, that particular leopard shark had been captured from the wild as a small, immature individual and started reproducing asexually when she reached maturity. But what had never been shown before in any shark was a switch from reproducing sexually to then reproducing asexually. So we still were not really sure what was happening. So the way that we went about determining which one of these mechanisms was responsible for what we were seeing was to investigate the DNA of these animals. And we looked for those genetic signatures that I explained before of sexual or asexual reproduction. And we had 14 DNA markers at which we were able to look for that. And this is what we found. So we were able to look at the DNA of three animals that were produced in the last mating season between Leo and Leonie, and we could clearly see that they had been produced sexually and had DNA from both of those parents. And then all of the embryos and pups that were produced after Leo had been removed only had DNA from one parent, the mother, and we were also able to determine that Lolly had produced parthenogenetically as well as Leonie. So this was very exciting, and we were very thrilled to actually be able to demonstrate that this shark had switched from sexual to asexual reproduction. And as a population ecologist, I was particularly fascinated about how this would impact these animals in the wild. And also over evolutionary time, maybe this is a strategy they've used in the past when they can't find a mate. And it seems that they're actually able to do this really quickly. So we showed it for this shark, and then there's also another case with an eagle ray who showed a similar thing. So she reproduced sexually when she had the mate. The mate was removed, she started reproducing asexually. So this kind of suggests that maybe this is a strategy that they use when mates are not available. But the offspring have greatly reduced genetic diversity. We could say that they're severely inbred, really. And from what we know about genetic diversity, this supplies the toolbox of genes that these animals need to deal with other things that are much more rapidly evolving, like pathogens and other elements of the environment. So genetic diversity is important. So what is this adaptive strategy, you know, of these severely inbred animals? Well, perhaps this is a really good short-term strategy. So a mate's not available. This is a way that that egg essentially can be taken into one or more generations. But in the long term, I think we do need boys. Anyway, so that we can mix up that gene pool again eventually. And I have a little bit of footage. Tony, please play that. So these are newly hatched baby leopard sharks. So you can see where the zebra bit comes from. So they actually have one of the most dramatic changes in patterning from the juveniles. So these are quite little. They come out at 20 to 30 centimetres. I know, it is very, oh. You want them as a pet, but they get to 2 metres long. They're not going to fit in your fish tank. These are the eggs that they develop in. So they've actually chopped the ends off to allow the babies to get out. So this one is very close to hatching. And this is candling. This is something that they do to check that the animal is still alive. And you can see its little nose there, its little mouth. So it was ready to come out in a couple of days. And then this is what it looks like when it's bigger. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Chris. I think we all have a wonderful, more appreciation for our baby sharks now, and go take some more photos of our own. Our final speaker tonight is Dr. Blake Chapman, also from UQ, a graduate of Marine Developmental Neuroscience and Ecology. Now, Blake's research now focuses on the science of shark attack in an effort to better understand these events for the benefits of both humans and for the sharks. Please welcome Blake Chapman.
Thank you. Good evening, and thank you for having me here tonight. I'm quite pleased to be here talking to you. I'm going to be talking about shark attacks and giving a bit of background on what's really going on, because I know that there's a lot of misconception, a lot of theory out there, but let's figure out what's actually happening. So I actually meant to leave it on the very blank slide. There was a reason that there is no pictures on that. And I was going to ask you what you would normally think of when I asked you to form an image of a shark in your brain. Having Chris up here just a minute ago, you might be thinking of the really cute, lovable little leopard sharks. But I imagine most of you are thinking about something more like this. And that's because we watch the news and we read the newspapers. And this is what we are told is happening out there. These are our sharks. This is obviously a great white shark. Mouth wide open, big serrated teeth, eyes rolled back in its head, those deep soulless black eyes that, you know, just have no compassion for anything. But this is our shark. So to start off on more of a factual foot here, this is a map that shows the reported confirmed unprovoked shark attacks. This is from the International Shark Attack File. There's a wealth of information on that website if you are interested. But this is showing where shark attacks have occurred from the year 1580 to the present. So when looking at this, I would like you to keep in mind this is nearly 450 years worth of data. Okay, it's a long, long time. So the areas that are colored represent the countries where shark attacks have happened. And the dots tell you how many. So the bigger the dot, the more shark attacks have happened. Don't pay attention to where the dots are. They aren't necessarily happening in the middle of countries. It's just representing the actual countries that have had them. So as you can see, the United States is a big winner. 1,352 attacks in 450 years. Not a big number. Australia pulls up second, 607. And the other places that I'd like to point out are South Africa, Brazil, and Reunion Island. These are unique, though. What we see here isn't the norm, okay? We do live in a place where shark attacks are prevalent, but the countries that report annually, reliably, on shark attacks are very few. It's these five places and maybe a couple others. So they are actually very unique situations where shark attacks occur on an annual basis in any country. We're told that they're prevalent, and I'll get into that a little bit later as to why, but really, they're just not. So we've got some stats here. This is from the last 10 years, okay? So 2007 to 2016. In the world, there were 766 unprovoked attacks, and just a little bit of terminology here. When I say attacks, it's a misnomer, okay? We use the term attacks because it's catchy. This is what the media tells us they are, but we've got a huge vocabulary, and attacks doesn't summarize it. In most cases, these are bites. They might be encounters, and in most cases, they're, I don't want to say harmless, but people walk away from them, don't go to the hospital, they wipe themselves off, and they go home, and then the next day, they're back out in the water. I don't want to say that this is always what happens. I definitely support the fact that there are occasionally attacks, even though science tells me that there aren't, and that terminology should never be used. I've spoken to people who have been attacked by sharks, and I would be saying that I was attacked as well. So the USA has the highest percentage, 59% of the global attacks, to be exact. Australia has the highest number of fatalities, but again, I'll come back to this in a minute. And the small island of Reunion Island off the east coast of Africa, so even further east to Madagascar, out in the Indian Ocean, has the highest percentage of fatalities. So they've got quite a small population, quite a small country, and unfortunately at the moment they are, I'll say plagued in relative terms, but they're being plagued by shark attacks and their fatality rate is quite high. So, like I mentioned, Australia generally has the highest number of shark bite fatalities each year. So, let's keep things simple. Last year, a couple months ago, do we know how many fatalities there were in Australia? This is the highest, we have the highest country of fatalities. Two. Okay, there are just two fatalities in Australia in 2016. This is slightly lower than the annual average, I'll give you that, of 2.8, and it happened amongst 15 unprovoked shark bites. The 15 was just above the five-year average of 13.2 unprovoked bites in Australia in a year, but it was lower than our highs in 2009 and 2015 of 22 and 18 bites, respectively. These occurred in New South Wales with 7 bites, Western Australia with 4, Queensland with 2, and Tasmania and Victoria with 1 each. And both of the fatalities last year were in Western Australia. So coming back to this table here, and just to finish it, as I mentioned, Australia has the highest number of fatalities per country on an annual basis, with 15 over 10 years, so an average of 1.5 fatal attacks per year. So what does this tell us? Well, I certainly do not want to trivialize the fact that 15 people lost their lives in what would be just a horribly traumatic and miserable experience. And I, like I said, I certainly don't want to downplay that at all. When you think about it in terms of other disease and major traumas, it is such a small number, 1.5 a year. So it's something to think about and keep in mind. But the other thing I think that we really need to think about is that we are having the highest number of fatalities. So Australia really needs to be a leader in shark attack mitigation. And in saying that, we also need to be a leader in shark attack conservation, because they are linked, and shark attack research. So it's something that we need to think about, and we need to be acting on this. So why Australia? Why do we have such a high number of shark bites, and why do we have such a high number of fatalities? First, we're a big country. We've got a huge coastline, so much bigger than any of those other places. America's just as big, but we've got a higher coastline. We also have a lot of sharks. Our environment supports them. We actually have a hotspot here. We have 180 species out of the 509 currently described species of sharks. So yes, there are over 500 different species of sharks. They are extremely diverse. We've got the little sharks, the really cute ones, and we've also got the big ones. And our bites reflect this. So some people have tiny little bites that don't do much, and other people are killed by these animals. So this is represented in the shark bites that we see. The other major thing that represents how we have shark attacks is our population. Okay, so New South Wales has quite a high population, very famous beaches, very well-utilized beaches, and there's a lot of shark attacks there. It's not a coincidence. Similar, Queensland has very prominent beaches, a great beach culture, and we have shark attacks. In the 180 species of sharks that we have, we also have the big three. Okay, we have white sharks, tiger sharks, and bull sharks. These guys are formidable predators. They are large animals. They're anatomically and physiologically designed to hunt very large prey to support their biology. They hunt marine mammals, they hunt marine turtles, so they are designed to cope with these different prey. And these are mobile species, they're very well-defended species, and yet the sharks predate on them. So they are designed to do this. They're also cosmopolitan species. What I mean by this is that they, through their normal migration and movement patterns, utilize our coasts. And it's coincidence, this is what we utilize as well. We love our coasts. People go out surfing, they go out swimming, and these are the environments that we occupy. It's also the environment that these sharks use. So it's a bad combination of extremely effective predators and an overlap with human use areas. And so we get the big bites. 56% of identified bites are related to these three species alone. So the big question, is shark attack incidence increasing? Yes, it is. It absolutely is. There's no denying that. But guess what? So is our population. And our population is increasing at a much greater rate than shark attack incidence is. We're spending a lot more money on shark attacks. We're financing and resourcing different things like the international shark attack files, so we know more about them. Our technology is increasing. More people have the internet. More people have the internet at home. Nothing is sacred anymore. As soon as something happens, it's out there, and we're talking about it. Okay? As soon as a shark attack happens, it's all over the media. It's all over social media, and it's global. It's no longer a localized experience. Everybody knows about it. So to that extent, there's been a study that's shown that for a single newspaper, this one in particular was in Western Australia, based on a single shark attack fatality, there could be up to 73 articles produced, with an average of 45 articles. So that is one newspaper reporting on a single incident of shark attack fatality might be talking about this 73 times. So it's no wonder that we think that this is happening all the time, because we are being constantly reminded about it. So while shark attacks are increasing, luckily the percentage of fatal attacks is decreasing, and it's doing so significantly. The 10-year average from this time period that I've been talking about has been 11.5% that have been fatal. In 2015, that was down to 6.1%. And in 2016, it was down to 4.9%. So that's less than half within the 10-year period that these numbers are actually even represented in. So these are major, major decreases. And the reason for this is greater education. We're more prepared for these things. We have quicker response time from our first aiders and our paramedics, and our emergency medicine has really started to take into consideration what needs to be done. We're learning more, we're understanding these things better, and we are more prepared for them. So just a little bit of details about shark attacks. This has been published in a study that's detailed what's happened since the early 1900s, so a bit over 100 years of history here. 76% of attacks have been non-fatal, and 24% have been fatal. And this is a major decrease, like I was saying. It's dropped from 60% that were fatal in the 1900s, the early 1900s, I should say. 7% of attacks result in limb loss or amputations. 80% happen to males, 10% to females, and 10% to an unknown group of people. But this, again, represents human water usage. There are generally more males in the water performing the activities, surfing, swimming, scuba diving. So again, shark attacks mirror human population. We've got 42% of bites happening to legs, 18% to arms, 7% to the torso, and 2% to the head and neck. Again, this isn't really surprising. Legs are what's in the water. If people are wading in the water or just playing in the surf, their legs are in the water, whereas maybe nothing else is. So that's the area that's going to be bitten. Similarly with surfers, they might be sitting on their board with their legs dangling in the water. That's a time that we often see shark attacks. So legs are more prevalent. Also for swimmers and scuba divers, their legs trail behind them. Sharks prefer to not be seen. They're mostly ambush predators. So they will go for the tail end of something so that they can get in first. They're scared. They're scared of us, as much as that sounds a bit funny. But normally, their prey will attack back. Like I said, they're formidable prey items that they typically go after. So they are trained to have that element of surprise. The 18% for arms, which is the next highest but significantly lower, also makes sense. These are also areas that might be paddling on a surfboard or could be in the water. If a surfer moves, it's often that arm that's the first sign of movement if they've been laying on their board, and so that's what the shark is going to see if the shark has been watching this person. The other thing with arms, though, is that people defend themselves. And don't get me wrong, I am not saying if you're bitten by a shark, don't defend yourself. By all means, do. Fight it. Don't just sit there. You'll die. Fight it. So use whatever you can. But know that by punching it, by going for its eye, by going for its gills, you are putting your arms and your hands in the danger zone. So arms tend to be secondary bites. And even if you just get it on, you know, with a punch, you're going to do some damage because of those scales that Ian mentioned. The last bit of information I have here talks about the number of bites. So 56% of people are bitten in one bite sequence. And by bite sequence, I mean that the shark comes in, it bites maybe a couple times, and then it goes away for one reason or another. Drops down significantly to 7% for two or more. So this means that the shark goes away and then comes back and starts biting again. Only 0.5% result in three or more bites. So I'll end with this, how to prevent a shark attack. Education and making smart choices. This is my most recommended tip. There is so much information out there. You can find information on how to mitigate a shark attack by yourself without spending any money, just by making some smart choices. On any of the Australian government websites that deal with sharks, you can look at the International Shark Attack File or the Australian Shark Attack File. There's a list, and it's a long list of things that you can do. Are these things effective? In a lot of cases, they could be. You're lessening the chance of being attractive to a shark. So it's worth trying it, certainly. I will say, though, that these things automatically exclude some people, so you might not be able to do all of them. The number one thing is swim at patrol beaches. This isn't going to be effective for surfers or scuba divers or a variety of other water users. So obviously that isn't going to be feasible there. But there's other things you can do. And you have to weigh up your risks. We've got a lot of personal mitigation measures currently on the market. These will also increase. We're going to be learning more about sharks. And as the incidence increases, people are going to be more and more scared. So there's more of a market for them. They range in cost from $100 all the way up to quite a few hundred dollars. Are they effective? It's controversial. There's a couple out there that have been independently tested. Even though that's happened, there's still mixed results. Nothing is 100% effective. That's the number one take-home message. You also need to do your research on these things. They're going to protect you from different species in different environments and during different activities. So you really have to think about what you're doing before you go out and buy something like this. But again, something is better than nothing. If it works, great. If it doesn't, it's going to give you a peace of mind, which is really probably the most important thing in terms of shark attacks. If you go back to those statistics, it's very unlikely. The other thing is regional mitigation measures, and these are what we often hear about in the news that our governments are working on. There's a variety of different regional mitigation measures that are currently out there. There's lethal measures, and this is culling, beach mesh netting, baited drum lines, things like that. There's non-lethal measures, which include exclusion nets, could be aerial patrols, or acoustic tagging and tracking. The areas covered by these methods are also very variable. They could be just one beach, or they could be an entire span of coastline. Again, are these effective? Maybe. They will probably help to reduce some incidents, but fortunately for the people who run them, they're extremely hard to actually quantify in their effectiveness. So governments love to say, what we're doing is working very well, but there are always going to be people out there who say, no, it's not, and we have these examples to say why it's not. The other thing that's quite contradictory in regional mitigation measures is our understanding of these devices or these measures. So again, I encourage you to do some research on them, look into them yourselves. Beach mesh nets probably are one of the most common forms of shark mitigation measures. We have them in Queensland, they're used in New South Wales, they're used in South Africa, and they've been around for a long, long time. These were the standard mitigation measures. They are finite in their distance. It could be from 150 meters to about 225, depending on where they're deployed. They don't go to the surface and the bottom, so sharks can swim around them, they can swim over them, under them, and 40% of sharks are caught on the beach side of the net. So these are sharks that have come in, done their thing, swimming around the beach, intermingled with the surfers, and then gone back out and gotten caught by the nets. The design and the purpose of these nets is to kill sharks. So the point is to reduce the population of the animals. It's not to exclude them from human usage areas. So it's important to understand what these things are doing. Similarly, aerial patrols are very poorly understood. These aerial patrols usually spend about 2 minutes over an individual beach when they're running. They often don't run all the time. It might be a weekend or seasonal time. So people often think that they are very well covered by aerial patrols. And they're extremely well recognized, and they do a great job when they're out there. But there are so many limitations that are on these things. So again, we really have to start to understand these things and make our own judgment and make our own informed decisions. And again, it all just comes back to education and making smart choices. So I will leave you with that. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I'd like to invite all the speakers now up onto stage. If you'd like to take a seat, maybe bring the chairs forward. There's also some water here if you'd like to grab some on the way through. Just a couple of bits of housekeeping. Obviously, we're here at the Edge tonight, and you might want to check out some of the other things that Edge has going on, including their inductions for their makerspace, where they've got CNC routers, 3D printing. The next round of inductions will be opening soon, so hop online and check that out. Also, BrisScience, of course, be back next month. We have a, for me, quite exciting talk next month, which is that Ben Milbourne, who's a TV chef you may have heard of, and I are coming to do a presentation on food science. So we have a new show presented by, on TV show at the moment, presented by UQ on Channel 10, The Food Lab, on Saturday afternoons. That's going really well. So we're going to do a few little excerpts from that and some fun things. So I think that'll be on a Tuesday night next month, so check the website for all the details. We have time for just a few questions, so if you've got them, wave them around in the air. Sorry, I should have said that first. In the meantime, I'm going to go to Twitter. We had the first question from wait for it, hold this thought. From Nicola, who asks, how do we know if attacks are unprovoked? Not sure who, if you're going to take that one.
There's currently quite a few definitions out there, and you can find these definitions on the attack files that detail them. So again, like I said, there's the international shark attack files, there's the global shark attack files, and there's the Australian shark attack files. Provoked basically means that the human has caused the interaction. So this might be in an aquarium setting. It might be for a diver who goes up and wants a really good photo of a shark, but its head is wedged under a rock. I'll point out wobbegongs are infamous for this, and divers. The diver might pull the tail, not realizing that wobbegongs can double back on themselves, and they will bite on very quickly and latch on, generally. They're not something to be messed with. So that would be provoking the animal. Feeding the animal would be a form of provocation. So there's a variety of things that go into that definition. Strangely, air-sea disasters are also not included in unprovoked. So if you are on a warship and your warship sinks, you're not going to be considered an unprovoked shark attack victim. But there are quite a few definitions that surround that.
I think if the shark takes down a warship, then more power to the shark. Like, you can have that one. Fantastic, thank you. Another question for probably Ian. Does wearing a wetsuit dampen the electrical signals that we give off so the shark's senses are confused?
No. Okay. Well, if you think the wetsuits are largely neoprene. Neoprene is like a sponge, so it has salt water all the way through it. So if you wear a wetsuit, the neoprene wetsuit, the regular kind of rubbery spongy suit you see divers wear, then the water actually permeates that. Your body heats up that water, so there's a salt water conductor between you and the body. So no, it wouldn't necessarily. But what it does do, which is really, really good, is if the shark bites you, it holds your guts in.
Bring your kids. It's a great evening for everyone.
Sorry.
Is there anything that does block? I mean, if you wear a Faraday cage, a mesh around you?
Yeah, no, a Faraday cage would do it, but it makes it difficult to swim.
That's not my main concern at this point.
If you swim in a Faraday cage, you want to swim in a cage.
Question.
A Faraday cage is like a wire shield around you. It soaks up the electrical signals. When we run experiments on sharks to determine their electrical sensitivity, because they're so sensitive, 1 volt equals 9 nanovolts, so we have to actually shield the experiment from all the electrical signals that surround us. So we build a Faraday cage around the experimental arena, and then we can work at trying to determine the sensitivity of the shark by its response to buried signals.
Right.
Oh, that's a good question, actually.
Was that question? Could you put the wire into
a
suit?
I don't know. If you want to volunteer for the trials, we'll give it a go.
PhD students.
Me? No, I'll use a student. Where's Brenton? There he is. You're next. Stand up, Brenton. Yeah, there he is. He's one of my 30th students. He doesn't realise we're getting into it yet. Anyway.
Question for Chris. Are the asexually reproduced sharks healthy?
So at the time when they were hatched, there were 6 in total that hatched out of the eggs, and currently there are 3 that are still alive. But one of the challenges is that even in captivity, juveniles that are born sexually will die in aquaria. It's difficult to control for all those different environmental conditions. So if they receive a deleterious gene, so a bad gene, you would assume that they probably wouldn't even make it that far. So there's probably a lot of animals that die very early stages of development. But we don't know how long these animals can live. There is a bamboo shark study that's shown a parthenogenetic offspring herself has reproduced parthenogenetically. So they've managed to live that long, and they mature around 5 years of age. So we don't know with these animals whether they can reproduce that way yet themselves. And one thing that hasn't been demonstrated at all in at all in any vertebrate is the capacity for these parthenogenetic offspring to mate and produce animals sexually together with a male. So that's something that will be looked at, and hopefully, I know that there are researchers around the world looking at doing that now as well. But how healthy they are compared to sexually produced babies, we don't know. So we haven't tested that per se.
Almost out of time, just a couple of quick more questions. For Blake, if I do get attacked by a shark, what should I do?
Well, it depends on what species you're being attacked by, how big of an attack it is. Like I said, fight. So the best way to fight a shark, a lot of people say punch it in the nose, but I think more, if you can, it depends on where you're attacked and how you can access it. You know, a lot of people get attacked by on the legs, so they are able to then fight it off. Going for the eye and the gills are going to be the most sensitive spots on a shark. They're designed to be very well protected. So their skin is incredibly tough. It's very difficult to damage a shark. So you need to go for the areas that are most vulnerable. I know a person who has survived because they were able to actually rip an eye out of a shark. And it sounds very gruesome, but they were fighting the shark for quite a long time. Nothing was coming of it. Their knuckles were down to the bone. They could see the bone. And they just had an instinct to then go for the eye, and they were able to survive. A lot of people also talk about going for the gills because that's a very vulnerable area. There's a lot of blood flow there, and sharks will try to protect those areas. So you just have to, as much as you can, keep calm, fight it as well as you can. I know it sounds funny, but people actually say that in these instances, they have had this just sense of rationality and calmness. It's that survival instinct. So do what you can and then get out of the water.
I've got one.
By all means.
Climb a tree.
Climb a tree. All those shark attacks in Central Australia. I've seen Sharknado. I'm going to ask my final question, just to bring it down a tiny bit. Ian, in a slightly more calm sense, what's the most exciting thing I don't know about gobies?
What? gobies? We're going to have a reproductive kind of theme this evening. So one of this genera of gobies called Valenciennes lives in a reef system. They build burrows. They grow up to about this long. And when it comes to breeding time, the pair build this burrow. And then the male and female, they have a pair bond throughout their lives. And then the male and female go into the burrow. And the female lays eggs. The male fertilizes them, separate sex and these things. Then the female leaves the burrow and then put rocks over the entrance to lock the male in. And the serious. And the male has to do all the care of the babies as they develop. So I reckon that's pretty good.
We've already received some fantastic life tips for a range of things tonight, and also some fantastic shark facts and information. So thank you all so much for your time this evening.
Wow.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Please join us for food and drink outside. We'll see you next month. Have a great one. Swim safely home.